Hi, everyone, and welcome to Night School. I'm Lynn.
I'm Aria.
And we're a part of the Nightlife Night School team at Cal Academy in San Francisco. We mix a little science, music, culture, and more, bringing this to you both in person at our weekly Thursday night nightlife events, which is where I'm at right now, and virtually on our monthly night school programs, which are on the first Thursdays of every month. Tonight, we're doing a little follow-up to our Nature is Nurture program from last month. But tonight we're focusing specifically on fire management. You'll be hearing from some of the people at the forefront of California's fire management and how tending fires builds resilience for forests and people alike.
Yeah, so just giving a quick intro to our lineup for today. First, you're going to hear from Deniss Martinez, who is a PhD candidate at UC Davis, and she's going to explain about the critical importance of centering Indigenous communities in all kinds of environmental decision-making, and specifically in this case, fires. Then you're going to hear from Ron Goode, who is the tribal chairman of the North Folk Mono, and he's going to share some insights into the history of wildfires and how they've become the destructive force that we see today, and how smaller human-managed fires across the landscape can help with habitat restoration and, you know, set new life cycles in action. So, yeah, it's going to be really, really great. We were originally going to also hear from a third guest, Elizabeth Azuz, but and she's from the Cultural Fire Management Council, but she's been busy literally out in the field as we speak, you know, doing the act of fire managing. So we're missing her, but we're super excited and grateful to have Deniss and Ron with us today. So, yeah.
Yeah. And as always, tonight's program is live, so make sure to continue saying hi and letting us know where you're watching from. We always love hearing if it's your first time joining or you're a night school regular. Tonight's program will actually have a joint Q&A with Deniss and Ron at the end of both of their presentations, so make sure to get your questions in the chat or comment box. And with that, we will now turn it over to Deniss.
Hi, everyone. It's so good to see you. If I could have my slides up, too, that'd be great. Thank you. So it's so good to be with you today. As Aria said, my name is Deniss Martinez, and I'm a PhD candidate at UC Davis in ecology. And today I'm going to talk to you a bit about environmental governance and Indigenous climate justice and how those principles literally shape the land. It's also such an honor to be here with Ron. I've learned so much from Ron, so I'm excited to hear what he's got to say. So a little bit more about who I am. So I'm a descendant of the Tutunaku people, which is an Indigenous group from Veracruz, Mexico. I grew up in Etna, California, a small town in Siskiyou County, where I first encountered the issue of wildfire and where I also came back to work with the Goode tribe as an undergrad, as a research assistant, and really started to do this research. I have my bachelor's in evolution, ecology, and biodiversity, a master's in ecology, and I'm now working on a PhD at UC Davis as well. So I love school. That's another thing about me. So today we'll be talking about decision-making, but my dissertation focuses on decision-making collaborations and policy surrounding cultural fire. So we will review a bit of the basics of cultural fire first. We will then jump to the connections to decision-making and policy and talk about future possibilities. Also how great it is to have this picture of Ron in my slides and having him on this panel as well. We were laughing about some good joke, I'm sure. So for those of you not familiar with cultural burning, some key points are that fire is essential to ecosystem function in California forests. This story might be contrary to what you have heard about raging wildfires in California. And part of the reason those big fires occur is because of the many years absence of active forest stewardship. Indigenous people were and continue to be experts at this through careful caretaking. Indigenous-led fire reduced fuels and forests that led to the wildfires that are high intensity. But it wasn't just managing fuels that led California Native people to burn. Fire was essential for almost every aspect of Indigenous life. Fire is so essential that many California Native people view their cultures as fire dependent. So fire is used to maintain key food and basketry staples, as well as wildlife habitat for elk and salmon, which are key species. Fire therefore uplifts Indigenous food and cultural sovereignty and ensures the well-being of California Native communities. So whenever I provide a list such as this, I like to throw in the caveat that it's not an exhaustive list, and each of these practices is informed by cultural values, institutions, and knowledge that can be different from tribe to tribe. So Indigenous knowledge is not just this list of practices, but rather the whole context of cultural institutions that put them forward. But I think that listing the practices can help us visualize what this looks like in a material manifestation. So settler colonialism disrupted these Indigenous practices in California by actually making fire illegal and actively suppressing it using a command and control approach to natural resource management that began in the early 19th century. Native people continue to practice cultural burning to the frustration of settlers that use this to instigate violence against California Native communities. Fire suppression has taken the form of violence, like shooting people on site for starting cultural fires, harassment and arrest for arson, and it has also taken the form of quote unquote slow violence, like the loss of native plants and cultural species, as well as the loss of safe forest conditions that has led to cultural suppression and large wildfires today. So slow violence refers to actions that create violence over time, like pollution in people's bodies, or in this case, like losing culture and healthy foods to fire suppression. These are slow in that it doesn't kill someone immediately, but causes increased risk for health and well-being over time. This is why people like Dr. Frank Lake, who is a Karuk and Yurok cultural practitioner, have framed cultural burning as a spiritual obligation and also an act of political defiance at times in the context of this government oppression and regulation. This is Frank with his son. So when I first became interested in cultural burning, I was mostly interested in plant responses to cultural fire. And this is still super interesting to me, but I realized the issue of implementing cultural burning as well as other climate solutions was the way we were making decisions about it at every level of our decision-making system. The hangups were more related to governance, and that got my attention because though there are people still opposed to climate change or active management, solutions that, you know, are widely accepted, you know, there are a vast majority of us that think these are important and want to do something about it. So I got hooked on the social sciences and humanities of governance and found, well, you know, climate change is a result of governance failure. And as suspected, our inability to build equitable, environmentally responsive decision-making structures has left us with a crisis that only grows daily. However, I do think that social sciences, humanities, and communities themselves have a lot to offer us in our quest to understand why this is happening, what we can do to push back, and perhaps most importantly, what to build in the place of the structures that have failed us. However, you know, like any time we're considering changing the assumptions and processes that we have upheld for a long time, this is also a massive opportunity for innovation and creativity at every level. Anyone has the opportunity to contribute, and there's a lot of work to be done. So like I mentioned, there's an opportunity for innovation in the ways we make decisions and even in who gets to make the decisions themselves. There is an opportunity to include equity and justice in a way that climate science and policy has not done before. And for Indigenous fire practitioners here in California, this means radically shifting the way we make decisions about forest and fire management to center Indigenous leadership, build tribal capacity, and ultimately address the massive forest health and fire problem in California. Ooh, so this is a very wordy slide, but I'm gonna walk y'all through it. So what are the governance challenge when it comes to cultural fire? So first and foremost, land tenure can be a huge challenge. California is unique in that treaties were signed here were not ratified by Congress. So most reservations in California were created in different ways, like executive order or an act of Congress. And this means that a lot of tribes in California do not have access to quote unquote jurisdiction in their traditional territories. This means that tribes have to find a way to share decision-making. Tribes that are federally recognized have some policies that they can lean on to do this, but federally unrecognized tribes are more often left out. So this leads us to decision-making. When tribes are able to get to the decision-making table, they are met with more challenges. The first is that they may share the table with people who may not respect their sovereignty or view them as equal partners. The second is that many times agencies make decisions on a large scale. So if you can imagine, you have decision makers in Sacramento or DC that are ultimately in charge of making decisions who might not be as up to date or in good relation with Indigenous people as maybe the local agency folks who are more on the ground. Policy is another challenge. Many times our policies and requirements are incompatible with adaptive management or Indigenous stewardship, either because paperwork takes a long time or people miss burn windows because paperwork can't be done, or the fact that wildfires sometimes in different parts of the state shut down prescribed and cultural fire in other places that are unaffected. Sometimes, you know, the state's decision directly conflicts with something the tribe believes is important. I guess the main point here is that we have this big bureaucracy that is our political system, and it's often too slow or too general to truly adapt like Indigenous stewardship demands. And though agencies are working on this to be more adaptable and more collaborative, we still have a long way to go. Public perception is the last challenge. I think, and I hope, that this has improved, at least from my perception, in the last couple years. But sometimes smoke and preservation concerns make people object to prescribed and cultural fire. So this is a flash overview of the challenges, and I'm sure there are some that I'm missing, but just to give you a basic picture. However, you know, there are grounds for hope. And here I give credit to my advisor who, you know, worked on this slide and encouraged me to remember that there are a lot of great initiatives happening too. And there are several state policies in the pipeline that support cultural burning. There are actually two current bills that are proposed that could make a real difference. And actually one of them, SB 332, which limits the liability for prescribed fire, making it so practitioners can only be held liable in cases of negligence, was just signed by Governor Newsom. Another is AB 642, which advocates for prescribed fire training, a cultural burning liaison, and tribal sovereignty. So these, you know, these are huge, and these changes are only possible via Indigenous leadership in fire, which is also getting more and more attention from the public, from journalists and policymakers, and some successful organizations are listed in that box. And there are also increased on-the-ground collaborations, which are very exciting. The training exchange workshops on the Klamath have Indigenous leaders and teach participants the cultural importance of fire. I believe that's where Elizabeth might be. And there are also, you know, several large collaborations that include partners across jurisdictions. One example of a collaboration like this that comes to mind is the North Coast Regional Partnership. And there are also some great learning opportunities that include TREKS, the training exchanges I mentioned, but also others that include academic and tribal partnerships. The UC Davis Keepers of the Flame course that we work on with Ron is one of these opportunities. So all of this to say is that we are living in a time of crisis, but also of great opportunity for innovation. So for forest and fire health in California, one big challenge is the prioritization of landscapes for treatment. Because there is a massive amount of land that requires prescribed or cultural fire, This will inevitably require a lot of resources. So we will need to find how to prioritize the landscape for funding in a way that aligns with our values. And we currently use quantitative mapping methods to measure ecological qualities of landscapes. However, when we talk about social, economic, or justice-related priorities, the state of California currently could improve its tools in order to better understand where our investments will create conditions for thriving of communities. And I recently got an opportunity to support the Science Advisory Panel of Forest Management Task Force of California with this exact question. So I'm going to share a bit of it with you here. Please know that this exists in an 80 plus page report on the internet. And unfortunately, I only have 15 minutes to tell you a little bit about it. So one solution I suggested is taking a social ecological systems approach, which recognizes the inherent interdependencies between social and ecological systems. And this might seem logical, but as of right now, our disciplinary boundaries between Western forest and fire science and conversations of justice, governance, and decision-making are just starting to come together. And most people are considering one side of the issue or the other. And conversations are not often centered around how these things are interdependent and you know how we could create solutions around that. So as agencies think about investment and are reviewing different projects, how might they measure whether a project is taking this approach? And this is where it gets a little bit more challenging. So in the report, we suggested considering these four large factors, which have a lot of sub-factors, using a qualitative rubric approach. So the four factors are partnership building, long-term commitment to place, building local capacity, and mobilizing traditional ecological knowledge. So we chose to measure these processes that can't be reduced to a handful of easily measurable variables. So we chose to do it qualitatively. So we provide guidance on how to evaluate a project for these factors. So the first is partnership building. All partnerships are not built equally, and we should evaluate them with a critical eye. So in addition to looking for the presence of collaboration, we should ensure that partnerships did extensive culturally relevant outreach. Early involvement of underrepresented community groups is essential for their perspectives to make an impact on a project. So early involvement should be seen as a plus. As people come together and sit at the decision-making table, it's important to note any inequities or barriers to participation. This may require providing travel or participation stipends, and there should be a process or a fund to be able to do this. So long-term commitment to place is important because it is the best way to engage adaptive management, which refers to the kind of management where we are consistently engaged in a cycle of planning, implementing, learning from that implementation, and then adapting. And then you go back into planning. So this means, you know, repeated treatments in a particular area, ongoing public engagement, and an institutional commitment to continue engaging in equitable collaboration with important stakeholders. It also looks like cultivating local leaders and letting those leaders have a voice in management. And this is important to make sure people on the ground have a voice. So building local capacity is critical for local employment and economic development. Giving local leaders and community members the tools they need to create and implement management plans will increase our capacity as a state to treat more land, but it will also create jobs, increase responsiveness to local issues, and ultimately make our responses more adaptive, relevant, and community-based. Last but definitely not least, traditional ecological knowledge or Indigenous science is a critical tool that must be a part of our climate future. Indigenous people have generations of intimate knowledge about California landscapes, and to ignore their expertise would be ignorant. However, Indigenous knowledge cannot be simply extracted from Indigenous people. Rather, we need California tribes engaged at all levels of leadership and forest management. In addition to this, a forest health project would demonstrate good inclusion of Indigenous science by including cultural aims as integral to a project. An excellent project would also have a plan to honor cultural protocols and data sovereignty. All of this to say that true collaboration and inclusion of Indigenous science requires sharing power. You cannot have Indigenous science as a part of our state plan without having Indigenous people sharing power, sharing decision-making, and having a voice. So evaluating these four factors is just one way the state could better include environmental justice, economy, and social well-being in their prioritization of forest health projects. That doesn't just treat acres of forest, but also could improve all of our well-being. So while the state grapples with how to do this, we don't have to sit by and watch. Everyone can participate by building our own capacity, by staying engaged and participating in local forest outreach, making public comment, taking care of either our private land or private land, you know, of our friends, of conservancies, go out there and volunteer and get on the land. You could also, you know, build your capacity by learning more about the history of settler colonialism and Indigenous activism. You can join in on direct action led by Indigenous people. And you know, and the list goes on, but you can take these four principles and find a way to participate in them from some aspect of your life. So with that, I just want to say thank you. And it was great. It's great to be with you all today.
Thanks, Deniss. So as a reminder to everyone, Deniss will be back after Ron's presentation and we'll do a joint Q&A there. So if you have any questions for Deniss, please add them to the comment or chat box. And with that, we'll turn it over to Ron now.
They left me backstage. Manahu. How's everybody? Hope you haven't all fallen asleep. You shouldn't have, because Professor Martinez did one heck of a good job describing policies and describing challenges and hurdles that have to be overcome. And so, you know, that was a wonderful presentation. There was a lot to chew on there, and you know, she kind of flew through it like a wildfire, but it's only 15 minutes. It's not much you're going to be able to really dive into, but still give you a good idea of what is going on in the state and around the state. So I'm going to come from a little different angle of where did we come from? How did we get here? Is there such a thing as good fire? What needs to happen? And we'll start with cultural burning and maybe even prescribed fire. First of all, you've been hearing this term a lot, and you're going to see it even more. Cultural burning is a relatively new terminology. We, however, have been burning culturally for thousands of years, and so it's not a new practice. It is a practice that we have lived by on the land for the existence that we've been out on the land. And my tribe has been out there on the land for 8,000 years, and we have some artifacts that say 15,000. So that's a long time on the land. taking care of the land. What did the land look like with the Indian out on the land? A man named Walker came over on the north side of Yosemite in 1834. And he made the statement that it was an easy hike because the entire trail was open, the entire forest was open. Fremont came through in 1844 and made the same similar comments about how easy it was to travel around through the forest, through the woodlands, and how open everything was. John Muir came in 1868 and, you know, traveled over the Sierras, and it was an easy walk for him as well. And when he got to the Mono, one of the things that he commented on was, oh, you know, all these Indians have to do is to come out of their teepee and they have a Garden of Eden. Well, that was probably true. But that Garden of Eden wasn't established overnight. And that Garden of Eden, you know, is from the way of life that we had on the land for all these thousands of years. But let's take another concept, and that is meadows. There are some 10,000 recorded meadows in the Sierra Nevadas. There's an Indian archaeological site attached to almost every meadow, sometimes in the meadow, near the meadow, down the road from the meadow. So what were these meadows were, and what did this terminology of openness mean? So in the forest, when the Indian was on the land, it was 40% canopy or less. And what that means is the thickness of your trees and you know, the distance, also known as basal, between your trees. So you have to have this openness to be able to see. We, as Native people, had a terminology called see-through concept. So this see-through concept was that I have children. I've been living on this land for 8,000 years. And my children play out there. But bears' children play out there, lions' children play out there, deer's children play out there, porcupine's children play out there, badger's children play out there. Everybody's children plays where my children play. We have one spring, maybe we have two, but we have one main spring. And, you know, deer takes her little babies down to get a drink at 10:20 in the morning. Lion, he owns a Rolex, man. You know, he's got it on his paw, and he looks at it, and he said, hey, 10:20, Mama Deer's going to be bringing her little ones down here. It'll be breakfast time, you know? So he lays waiting, see if he can get himself some breakfast. Bear, he's sitting over there in the shadows, and he's going, yeah, you go, lion, because when you get done, I'll be the cleanup man. Well, what happens when lion doesn't get one of them pretty little fawns? Then he's going to be looking at your pretty little fawns, you know, and we're not going to survive and be out there on the land for 8,000 years if we have to share children every now and then. So that the other species can survive. They're going to need to learn how to survive. You know, they might have to become vegetarians. But in a sense, the being in and around a meadow is also our refrigerator. And we live out here on this land, so we can't afford to walk 10 miles down to the store and buy our groceries. We can't afford to go to the pharmacy when we need medicine, because that's a day's hike to get down there and then another day's hike to get back. Well, if I got a sick child, sick wife, they're probably dead by the time I get back. And then I got to go hunt, and then I got to go someplace. I'll never be at home. I'll always be, you know, walking someplace to go get something. So it didn't work that way. I had to have all my resources right there. I needed my 300 resources and my 95 food items within reach. And on occasion, I might go trade with my neighbors. So we also look then to the meadow, and that's where the water is. And so, you know, all of our plants and our flowers, when you have the vegetation growing, the bees are going to come, the dragonflies are going to come, the butterflies are going to come, deer is going to come and eat the young oaks, and you know, squirrels are going to be coming to look for nuts, and it goes on in the cycle with all of the different species that are going to be coming, you know, to your home. This is where you live. This is how you have to take care of the land. But let's use a modern day analogy of if you're a parent and you go to the mall and there's 1,000 people in the mall, and you're holding on to your little children's hands as hard as you can, but you see these beautiful little red shoes, you know, you just got to admire them. So you turn to look at them, and the next thing you know, you've looked at those little red shoes too long, you turn around and your children are gone. There's 1,000 people going through, and you're like, what happened to my children? You panic. Where are my children? Well, you fight through the crowd, and there's your children on the other side looking at puzzles and looking at games and, you know, looking at stuffed animals, and they were doing the same thing you were. So now you're happy again. But put yourself out on the land. And now understand that panic. If you're out there and you can't see through the forest, when you see lion walking around, when you see bear walking around, where are my kids? It's 10:20. It's time for deer to come down and get a drink. I better know where my children are. Well, today, fast forwarding to where the creek fire just burned down here, 378,000 acres. And now we got the Dixie fire up there that's tripled that. And everything's too thick. Everything is 80 to 90% in thickness of canopy. And that's why it burns. And this is a result, as Deniss just told you, of, you know, colonial attitudes, which comes back into the late 1800s, pre-1850, the Indian was on the land, to 1900, 1910, when the American decided that they need trees. And we need trees, and we need lots of trees. So we need to, you know, shoot or hang these Indians when they light a fire. But at the same time, we need to plant trees. And that's what we need to do. And of course, that's what they did. And they're still doing it. I ride around with the Forest Service out in the woods before the fire. And some forestry guy is just elated over the fact that, you know, we come up on a whole mountainside and there's all these trees that are the same height and they're growing like toothpicks. And he's proud because he planted that 25 years ago when he started his job with the Forest Service. But he never once came back to tend the garden. He never once came back to thin out his crop. He just let them all grow. So when the drought came and the bark beetle came, they took out his grove. And when you looked out upon the land and you seen 150 million trees that were hit by drought and the bark beetle, they were all the same size. No more than 50 years old. And all growing like toothpicks. Where the Forest Service had worked on 100 acres and they had it thinned and it was 40% open canopy, these trees were nice and big and they never got hit once by any bark beetle or the drought. Where the tribe, my tribe, has been working in and around 15 different meadows, restoring these meadows, bringing them back to life. Within the meadow, and within the edge of the meadow where we've been working, not one tree was succumbed to drought or the bark beetle. Outside of it was all orange. Why? Because when those trees are open, they are able to absorb enough water, and that water thickens their sap, and their sap creates a defense, so the bark beetle is in control, is not in control, and cannot bore through. But another thing that you may not understand at that point in time is that when we restore these meadows, we take a toll on and a monitoring count on who lives here, what kind of plants, what kind of species, what kind of habitat, what kind of wildlife. Every ant, every dragonfly, every housefly, every mantid is counted. And you say mantids? Yes, because wherever the mantid is, you might be lucky to find one or two bark beetles. You might be lucky to find them. Where the mantid didn't roam, you'll find the opposite, lots of bark beetles. So the mantid controlled them. So I have a little story in which we were restoring we restored our meadows from 3,400 foot elevation all the way up to 6,000. And in my higher elevation meadows, I had plenty of mantids, but down below I had none. And I had a lot of drought trees and bark beetle trees encroaching upon my meadows, coming, it's just inevitable after a bit because everything was orange outside of the meadow, pretty hard to keep it from wanting to come in. So eventually, one day, I'm out on our lowest meadow, and I see this praying mantis. And he looks at me kind of sideways and looks up at me, and I look down at him. I said, "What took you so long to get down here?" He put his head down for a moment, then he raised his head back up and he said, "Do you know how far it is from up there and how many meadows there are in between?" I said, "Okay, all right. But I'm happy now because if you're here, all your cousins are coming too. So we're good now. Life is going to be back in order." But where are we? Where are we, as Deniss is telling you, in policy. Oh, there's some new policies going. Some that are signed right now. Personally, I'll give you 2 cents for them. They're going to help. They're going to help a lot of people. But when we look at what cultural burning is about, cultural burning is about culture. It is not about the landscape. It is not about resources. It is about the culture of the people, the sustainability of the people to be able to practice their culture, the traditionalist and the traditional way of life. The basket maker, and we have very famous basket makers, the basket makers tell us, what kind of stick do they need to make a good, high quality basket? You can't just go out there and grab anything and cut anything. I've seen basket makers go out there and cut 800 sticks and tell me, I found 75 out of that 800 that was decent, Ron. So when we do cultural burning and we put fire on the land, I'm putting fire on the land to create a spot and a resource that that basket maker can come out the following year, sit down in one spot, and have their annual harvest. I'm burning so that the gatherer is going to come out and gather berries in the summertime and fill up their bags and fill up their boxes, and they're going to come back again with more family members and more tribal members, and we'll have a dozen tribes there because the resource is plentiful and the bush is producing the way it's supposed to produce. We have burned under the oaks, creating, going from where we had 62 black oaks and 49 golden oaks, two or three golden oaks producing a little bitty acorn and three black oaks producing a handful of acorns. A black oak should be producing at least 200 pounds of acorn. And if it's a mass producer, it can produce up to 400 pounds of acorn. One tree. And I should be able to come to that one tree and gather from it three times from September to November, end of November, December. And I got 62 trees. They all need to be producing because that's what Creator did. He did not make trees that were dormant. I argue with my botanists that when they come out there on the meadows with me and they say, oh, this is a woody strawberry. I said, what in the world is a woody strawberry? Oh, it's a strawberry that doesn't produce strawberries. I said, excuse me? Creator never made no strawberries that couldn't produce right. There's something wrong with that picture. Next year, I invited her back out to try some of these delicious little strawberries. I said, hey, isn't this your woody strawberry that you're eating strawberries from out of your hand? Because Creator didn't make resources like that. Everything needs to be producing. We need to know how to do that. And that's culture. That's not just me walking out on the land and putting fire on the land. And the other aspect of one of the bills that was just passed is all talking about, you know, burn boss. Got to be a burn boss. And, oh, the state's going to protect you now with liability and, you know. Well, that's nice. That is. But I'm not a firefighter. I'm not an igniter or a suppression fighter. I'm a burner. I know how to burn. Worldwide, whether you're in Australia, Canada, Florida, New York, or here in Central California, we are burners. It is prestige to be a burner. The head women, the head burners are a lot of times women in Australia, and they have the same prestige as their chiefs. Because that's the importance of it. And it's the same way here. You don't, oh, you'll see some yellow, little yellow jackets running around our fires because somebody's got to bring their little yellow jackets. That's fine. We don't pass out no yellow jackets. We don't wear no yellow jackets. We don't wear blue ones. We don't wear green ones. We don't wear hard hats because we're burners. We know how to burn. And because of that, then, you know, the differences between how agencies are putting fire on the land and what they're burning for. I have not met an agency yet, and I've been burning with all of them for quite a few decades. When the fire people for the forest, I asked, what are you burning for? Why are you burning? Oh, we're burning for acreage because we get paid by the more acreage we burn, the more money we get. You know, I say, ask the part, what are you burning for? Well, we got to burn the grass around these houses so that, so in case a wildfire does come, you know, it won't burn these houses. Pretty good idea. But what about all the species? What about all the animals that live here? Who lives here? Forest can't tell me, park can't tell me. They can give me a list of all the endangered species, but nothing else. So, you know, we have a long ways to go yet here in California and even in amongst our own Indian people. There's groups in some of these bills that Deniss was talking about where there are folks who think they're going to go out and do training, help people get trained. Hey, that's fine. They got programs like the TREX program where they teach you to be a firefighter and you can get your little red card and put on your little yellow suit. And now the government says it's okay for you to be a cultural burner now. You know? We're not a federally recognized tribe. We're not an unacknowledged tribe. We're an Aboriginal tribe. My tribe has 1.4 million acres. Our treaties were never signed. My tribe still has 1.4 million acres. And that's the way we look at it. We need to take care of our homeland. We need to take care of the forests that are out there. The agencies that are in charge, their thinking is, you know, somewhere between 50 and 100 years behind us. So how long is it going to take us to get caught up? When will they actually start listening and get an understanding of what needs to be done? I know that my time is probably up. So I will end basically with that. And, you know, I'll just end right there. Thank you very much.
Hi, Ron. Thank you so much. I was just sitting here entranced by your stories because I feel like I was out there in all the places that you were describing and, you know, obviously not with the same knowledge, but just, yeah, thank you. And hi, Deniss. Good to have you back. And I will go ahead and ask a few questions now. Kind of broadly and maybe to both of you individually and everybody out there who's watching, feel free to add some questions in the chat if you have any. One that came in immediately was from Linda, and she says, it's so obvious that Ron and his community know the best ways to work with the land. What will it take for agencies like the U.S. Forest Service to listen and put these practices in place? And Ron, you kind of started talking about this, but I would love to hear more of your thoughts on it, as well as Deniss from kind of that like policy perspective.
Go ahead, Deniss, if you wish to start.
Go ahead.
You waited too long. I just resigned from what is known as the Dinky Collaborative, and there's 22 landscape restoration collaboratives in the United States, and we have the lead one in the United States in the Sierra National Forest. And there are 35 charter members, and I've been a charter member from the very beginning. And there are loggers, there are environmentalists, there are forestry people, there are private land people, there are tribes. There are college professors and, you know, ecology scientists and all sorts of folks that were part of the collaborative. We had $10 million, and for 10 years, I would spend 1 to 2 days a month with them, volunteering my time. The forest people that worked with the Dinky were paid by the Dinky Collaborative. So at 5 o'clock, they went home. You know, the tribal people that were paid people by the tribes, at 5 o'clock, they went home. And in the end, after 10 years, no matter what we tried to convince the collaborative that we needed to do meadow restoration, we needed to do cultural resource restoration, we had chosen about 6 different oak groves, which had 30 to 60 black oaks that needed to be burned. The oak doesn't, you don't go and burn the oak. You burn under, you burn through. Mm-hmm. You're taking care of the weevils, you're taking care of any other parasite, you know, and then you come back and then you build small fires and you smoke the tree so that you're beginning to open that tree up so that it can start to be an acorn producer. But we couldn't convince them to spend a dime on any of that. And all they spent it on is going out there and lighting their fires, you know, burning 700, 800, 1,000 acres. And their goal is to burn, you know, 40,000 to 50,000 acres. They'll never reach it in their lifetime because they only burn 1,500.
Yeah. You know,
that's their goal. So after a while, it's like, what am I doing? You know?
Yeah. So it sounds very much like I don't mean to cut you off.
Just go. Yeah. That's just an example.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. It sounds like it's so much about what, like how to burn and where to burn and focusing those efforts way more than just let's burn this part and, you know, this other part. Right. That's what it sounds like. Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Ron. Deniss, did you have something that you were going to add?
I guess my first reaction to that question is I don't know, because when I talk to Ron and other Indigenous folks who are burning, I feel like it just makes sense. And but from a more like empathetic standpoint, I think that there's a couple things that would need to happen. One is that we really need to reckon with the genocide that happened in California and all of the violence that is kind of wrapped up with, you know, with fire, with the way that, you know, our land jurisdiction works, like all of that. We need to contend with the really difficult history of that. And I think on the other hand, there's, you know, there's a lot of issues like what Ron has been saying. And one of the reasons why we wrote this prioritization report and we included this information about how to have a good project, a good collaboration that kind of addresses equity, justice, social, and economic factors, because acreage is important. I understand the urgency that maybe people and agencies feel when it comes to like, I need to burn a lot of acres. There's a lot of acres to treat in California, but burning acres doesn't do much if you're not building the social, economic, if you're not building the good relationships with people to be able to do that continually. And that's, it's like, we're trying to do something without that infrastructure of relationships, of, you know, working with tribes and actually giving them power in a collaborative and not just naming them and then ignoring them. All of these things are super important to be actually able to build our capacity beyond just like this mad rush for acres. And again, I understand that fear and that urgency around acreage, but I just think we could slow down and think about it in a more systemic and holistic way.
Yeah, that completely makes sense. I'm very on board with the, like, you know, I hear somebody like Ron speak about his experiences with burning and it's like, yep, okay, cool. Like, that makes sense. And kind of along that line of urgency, another question that Stephen in the chat brought up was, is the present drought going to last several years or longer? And how will things like this affect, you know, building these kinds of infrastructures and relationships because of the urgency and the push? And yeah, do you both, can you both speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, I'll take the first shot at it while Deniss contemplates it. First of all, we're in a 34-year drought right now. I was one of the climate change authors and the lead one for the tribes in 1918. You can see my report online, and there's an article on drought. So we, back in 450 AD to 1650 AD, you know, we had two mega droughts. One of them was 250 years, then we had 50 years of flooding, and the next one was 180 years. We had three global warmings from 650 to 1100. One in the ocean, one in Tulare Lake, and one in Tahoe Lake. These were all recorded archaeologically. From 1500 to 18, from 1550 to 1850, we had 10 to 20 year droughts every century. We've had a number of droughts here in California. You know, that's what the Dust Bowl was all about in the 30s. But again, in the 60s and in the 70s, and then it started in 80s, 87, 87 to 93, 5 year drought. And then we had an El Nino for 2 years. And then we came back with another 3 years of drought. And then we had flooding. It wiped out the bridge on the San Joaquin River. And then we had two more years of drought. And then we had rain. And then we had two more years in 2007, 8, and then the governor extended it in 2009 for political reasons. And then we had decent water till 2012. And then we had another drought, and that lasted until 2015, but the governor extended it to 2017. 2016, we were 4 inches over in precipitation and 8 inches over in 2017. So we were well over our water capacity, you know, that we were getting, but we were still in the drought. And because the governor wanted to take care of farmers, irrigation people, lobbyist, you know, that's we're always playing this political game, as Deniss has pointed out to you. And then we come into 19, 20, and 21, right? So we never met, we have not met the rain capacity for 3 years. But in 19, we had 165% snowpack. And in 20, we had 120% snowpack. But in 21, we only got 65% snowpack. So in March, the moment that it said we only had 65% snowpack and our rain was still at 4 and 5 inches, then the farmers started screaming, we're in a drought. And what happened? Immediately they start tilling up their ground. And immediately a wind comes and takes all their topsoil away instead of planting grasses, instead of doing something with it. But by tilling up their ground, the governor's now going to pay them for the crops that they tilled up because we're in a drought. The governor could not state that the state of California was in a drought because that didn't end until September 30th. But on October 1, we have already been issued, that we're in a drought and everywhere needs to lower and conserve water by 15%. It'll go to more than that before the new year comes. Because in the past, when 2015, we had to drop 25% in all of our cities, everywhere, everybody. This drought is not over. We are just now, we're in this one. They're going to go back 2 years. It may last another year. And then we'll have water. And then we'll go back. We can do this for another 20 years. We could be in this thing for 50 years. But I'm about the only one that's calling it a 34-year drought. Reality, in between, we've had flooding. So how can that be a drought? But climate change is creating this unpredictability that we are in, and how, the atmospheric rivers that we now have and the ocean warming because of climate change. Well, as Deniss pointed out, we as people have created some of this. We created it because on the San Joaquin River, we have 15 dams. Well, my knowledge of Creator and my knowledge of God is that He didn't put no dams on the San Joaquin River. The water was meant to go to the ocean to cool it down. Rather, it's the San Joaquin, the Sacramento, the whatever river goes out to the ocean. It is designed to cool the ocean down. So if the ocean is rising and the ocean is getting warmer and more ice is melting up north and down south, we're responsible for that because of how we think. These dams were built for farmers, and agriculture started in the 1930s. Oh, we've been doing agriculture for centuries, all of us, every race. But commercial agriculture started in the 30s and was elevated in the 50s when the big dams were built up north, right? Well, farmers, you can talk to farmers. Farmers will tell you, what happens if we hit another 5 or 6 year drought and the water is gone? Is the farmer going to be able to buy the water? He will not be able to afford it because the urbanite will buy it up. The people in the city will own it. They're not going to give it to the farmers. They can grow their tomatoes in their windowsills along with their pot, and they can grow corn out on the decks along with whatever else they want to grow out there. The people in the cities will just grow their own food. We won't be dealing with the farmers. They'll be gone because they can't afford to buy the water. It's a serious issue. And when I talk to the irrigation people and the farmers, not a single one of them will come to meetings about the upper watershed. There's no money being put into the upper watershed. We have 10,000 meadows. 70% is need of maintenance or repair. 25% is non-existent, and only 5% of our meadows is healthy and functioning. Well, we ain't got much time left if that's what we're doing. right?
Yeah. No, absolutely. Yeah, there have been a few more comments in the chat saying about how it is a really terrifying and depressing, heavy situation that we haven't historically looked to Indigenous people and the people who've been living here for so, so long. And,
I know we got to go shortly, but listen to me.
Yeah.
I'm an old man. I ain't got much time, much longer time be doing what I've been doing for all my life. But younger people like Deniss, like yourself, all these people that are on this listening right now, that's where you need to be. As young people, this is your world. You're going to have to take it over. And I tell all the young people, and I tell it right in front of everybody, don't go to work for these agencies. Let all those old dogs die and retire, because they cannot change. And they're not going to change. So just let them fade away. And when they're gone, then all of you young people who've been trained and been taught how to do things right can come in. We can turn things around. And it'll be like a tsunami, because there are just, thousands of you young people who understand what needs to happen. But every time a young person comes to work for an agency, that agency just grabs them by the throat and says, you will not do anything but the way we want you to do it. So why go to work for these people? Just let them fade away and have their good time for the next couple, few more years. You'll outlive them, and then we can make changes.
Yeah, and times are changing fast. So, lots to look forward to. And thank you so much, Ron. It's a scary situation, but I mean, you're right. Things will grow as time goes on. Deniss, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I was just going to say also, I think that there's this growing group of people that want to see change. And I think for me, anyone, even, folks in agencies who want to work with tribes, but maybe feel like they can't for some reason, or don't have, the resources to do it in their jobs. And a lot of activists and, a lot of youth that just want to see things change. And I think that individually, it's like that jump from I want to see things change to I can change things. I can, take steps, and I can, join movements and organize. And making that jump, once more and more people make that jump, that's going to really change things. And so, just talking to students, pep talking to myself as I finish my grad program, I'm just, making that jump can be as easy as a step. Sometimes it feels like a huge leap, but just taking it and saying, I'm going to do something today that brings me closer to land. I'm going to do something today that joins, the climate justice movement. I'm going to go to a march. I'm going to, call a senator. I'm going to go out and do a burn with Ron. All of these things seem small in the moment, maybe, but they make a big change when you think about it from a community perspective. You're a part of a community that wants to see change. And, you're putting in your grain of rice and you're putting in your little contribution, but you're a part of a community, and all of you contributing makes a big change.
Yeah, absolutely. It emerges. I love that. And one last question, just to close us out here, but for all the people out there who are still learning, like myself included, Deniss and Ron, do you have any recommendations of places to start reading up, learning, like whatever we can on our end to learn and make that mindset change, like you were saying, Deniss, about making that change?
I think there's some very logistical teacher resources Ron has a lot of really great videos that he's worked on with different people. I really like his K-set videos. I don't know, Ron, if you still really love those. I still show them in class, and they're really helpful as an intro and as kind of like a teaching tool for yourself or for your class or for your friends. That's actually just like really beautiful. Like the video is beautiful and you learn a lot. So there's that. There's been a lot more conversation about this online. So people have a lot of like op-eds and other, you know, non-expert papers, which I really like to read. Yeah, and then of course there's, you know, books and scholarly publications that you could read, you know, like Dr. Frank Lake, who I mentioned in my presentation. He writes a lot about this. Ron writes a lot about this. My advisor, Dr. Beth Rose Middleton, is also a great resource. So people are talking about it. It's just, you know, have to find those resources. Ron, do you have suggestions?
Well, that's, you know, that's a good start right there. We as Indigenous people are now being given the opportunity, and the door is opening for us to be able to produce writings from our views and with our styles. And so I'm currently writing an article right now that's will be coming out, I hope, in December with the Great Basin Journal on prescribed fire and Indigenous fire, Western science and Indigenous science. What is the difference? Is there a gap? Can we have compatibility? You know, can we go down this road together? For the most part, at this point in time, with Western science and Indigenous science, I use the bad analogy that, you know, it's a two-headed snake. We're on the same body. They're looking in one direction. We're looking in the other direction. We're not looking in the same direction, but we're on the same body trying to move forward. I want to go this way. I want to go that way, you know? So until it comes to the point to where we both start looking to where we need to go, Western science up to now and agencies feel like they have to validate anything that we say. So in the climate change report, as the lead author, the agencies and the editors that came in pulled people up from Oklahoma and Arizona and who knows who they were and where they were from. Oh, these people talked about what you're saying, so it's okay for you to say it. Like, who are you and what do I care, you know? But I'm sorry, you have to be validated. You can't just make statements, you know, that. And so that's what we're still getting. That's still happening, you know, even though, but now we're at a point to where, for those of us that are being accepted a little bit more, it's like, you know, I'm writing it and I'm talking to you and I'm telling you the way it is, and if you don't like it, well, too bad. But there's not a time when I'm not on the video or Zoom that I'm not getting a serious pushback. So serious that it does get under my skin, and that's pretty hard to do. But when people start telling me that when an Indian speaks, it's nothing but myth, that when an Indian speaks that, you know, he doesn't really know what he's talking about. And they post that right on your site, but they won't post their names, you know, because they're too afraid to do that. You know, I'm not afraid to tell you what I think. Why is it you can't tell me who you are? You know, but they do that. And I don't think I've ever spoken anytime, and I am on radio and I'm on newspapers and TVs and Zooms 2 or 3 times a week, 4 times a week, and there's always negative comments. Always. So, you know, that's what we still have to deal with, but not everybody can deal with that. You know, that's what Deniss is alluding to and saying, that, you know, if you want to be somebody because you got a lot of knowledge and you want to share your knowledge, you're going to get shot at. And you may not be able to take it. You may not be able to take it because it's a word that we're using in our article, but it's solastalgia. It's about the fear that people have when they've experienced something dramatic in their life, like PTSD, or, you know, if you've been through a fire, if you've been through a wildfire and your house has been burned, you know what that's all about. And there are people, then, even this pandemic has created that, the emphasis of that word. And there are people who, just the moment you start talking, how can there be good fire? You know, how can you tell us that there's good fire? Because look what it did. I have so many people tell me, look at the destruction of 378,000 acres burned by the Creek Fire and the 900 homes lost. You know, and I got friends and buddies who lost homes. But when I'm out on the land, there is so much water. We did 9 meadows this summer, assessing them for the forest. Every single one of them were sopping wet in June, and still wet in July, and starting to dry a little in August because of all the water and nothing sucking it up. There's always something good that comes from a disaster. I'll quit.
No, that was, I love listening to you talk, Ron. I can listen to you keep talking. I'm serious. I'm just kind of like sitting here like this because I'm,
well, we could be here till midnight. It's already 8:18.
Yeah, we could keep going.
Your boss is going to get mad at you.
Yeah. Well, in any case, thank you both so much for coming on. It's been an absolute pleasure and privilege. You're both like absolutely incredible scientists and humans, and I'm really, really like personally grateful also to be learning from you. And we have a lot of really, you know, thankful and excited, happy, grateful comments coming in, so in the chat. So thank you everybody for tuning in, and I think we're gonna bring Lynn back on for
a- I gave a couple of videos that I didn't get to show. Share them.
Yeah, you know, absolutely.
You're welcome to share my email.
Great, sounds good. Yeah, for everybody out there, we'll put some more information and a few more links to stuff to read, and Deniss and Ron's contact information, so you can go check it out on your own time. But yeah, sounds great. And I think Lynn will bring we'll bring Lynn back up for our final farewell here. But thank you both again so much.
Thank you, Aria.
Hi, Lynn.
Hi. That was a great conversation. And I just also want to echo Aria. Thanks, Deniss and Ron, for sharing all your knowledge with us and our audience. With that, thank you viewers for tuning in again. As a reminder, Night School is monthly, so we'll be back on the first Thursday of November, which is November 4th. Next month, we're bringing you Light School. We'll be talking all about bioluminescence and the inner workings of nature's glow.
Yes, indeed. And stay tuned for that. Subscribe down below, or, you know, follow us on, like us on Facebook. I think you'll end up following us if you do that. But yeah, stay in touch. We're excited to see you all next month. Thanks for tuning in.